station. Drivers in Dallas panicking at the pumps. Long lines of cars waiting to pay as much as $4.50 a gallon. The governor of North Carolina declaring a state of emergency, anticipating gas shortages across the southeast. Newly released before and after satellite photos show what is now an incredible scale of devastation. I want to show you this. Simonton, Texas, 40 miles east of Houston. There, as you see, unbelievable flooding. A couple drowned there after accidentally driving into that flood water. 35 miles west of Houston. This is Brookshire, Texas. This area especially hard hit by Harvey. You see that incredible overflow. Once again, our reporters are covering this story from every angle, all across the zone. We begin with Miguel Marquez out front tonight outside the Baptist Beaumont Hospital where patients are being evacuated. Miguel, this evacuation, obviously terrifying for those involved, and it has been going on all day. They just don't have water.
Yeah, this is like a military operation here. The good thing here is that the evacuation here was not in anger. It was not in haste. This was not a situation where the flood waters were rising up on the hospital. The city ran out of water and they had to move people out. They have been doing that all day long. You have helicopter after helicopter moving patients to Jasper or Galveston. Typically, they would move them to Houston, but they can't do that because Houston is so inundated right now. The situation here is unclear when it will be rectified. Keep in mind, this is a city of 120,000 people, the county around it, also many more thousands of people. They found out on very short notice that their water was going away. They found out overnight as well. One of the pump stations failed on the Neches River as it went up and up and up. A second one failed just north of here in Hardin County, where they get about 30% of their water. And then that was it. The water literally ran out across the city of Beaumont. The river is not meant to crest until tomorrow at this point, which means they can't even get to the place they need to get to, those pumps at where it draws water off the Neches, to figure out what they need to do to fix the system. It is a major emergency here. And keep in mind, all of this on top of the massive, massive rain that they've had in this area. 300 water rescues today alone in the city alone of Beaumont, 1,000 overall. I can tell you, I just flew from North Houston to here into Beaumont. Areas along the way, like along the Trinity River, out in the middle of nowhere in Texas, it is underwater. These little tiny towns, how long it will take for them to get help and get back to normal, it's impossible to even say. Aaron?
All right, Miguel, thank you very much. And you talk about that fear of not having clean water. It is a race against time to rescue many families who are still trapped in the deadly floodwaters, which, of course, are rising and still rising and perhaps not even going to crest till tomorrow in some cases. Anderson Cooper is out front live in Houston. And Anderson, I know you went on board a U.S. Coast Guard helicopter. You helped to rescue people. I wanted to show everyone a look at one of those rescues.
That's Eric Berevescos, the flight mechanic.
Anderson, what was it like up there today?
You know, it's interesting because the crew, when they started out early this morning, they didn't really think today there was going to be a lot happening. They kind of thought today, given the weather, given the length of time that has passed, that there wouldn't really be much need for rescues. By the end of the day, they had gotten 15 people, helped them get to safety throughout the course of several hours. So to watch them work, though, is really extraordinary. First of all, even though the skies are clear, the weather is good, rain is not an issue for them, it is very dangerous flying up there. There are a lot of choppers in the air from a lot of different agencies, from the military, from the Coast Guard, and others. They have to keep a constant watch, turning their heads all the time, left and right, up and down, to make sure they know where the choppers are in their area. And as you said, you talked about all those boat rescues a short time ago. They really try to focus on areas that they don't see a lot of boats. They basically scan the ground. Yeah, they get some 911 calls. They are able to respond to direct addresses. But for the most part, it's all just visual. People on rooftops asking for help. And they go to areas where they think boats can't get. They go to areas that aren't near main roads because they figure that's the area that a lot of boats aren't going to get, or people near a highway are going to hear people yelling. So that's what they focus on. But it's really like finding it at times like a needle in a haystack. There's a lot of tree cover. They have to fly very low. It is very dangerous for them. but their precision is extraordinary. When they see somebody, they swoop in, they hover about 150 feet over that person. They lower a rescue swimmer who goes down, who assesses the situation, then they lower a basket, they bring people up, often with their pets, and they bring them to safety. It's extraordinary to watch. They plan, though they thought today wouldn't be busy, it was. They're gonna be out there again tomorrow. The Coast Guard says they have rescued or aided as many as 9,000 people so far in Texas and Louisiana.
Incredible numbers. All right, Anderson, thank you very much. And I want to remind everybody that tonight Anderson has NFL star J.J. Watt with him, who has helped raise more than $12 million for victims of the storm. That's coming up with Anderson. And now I want to go to Ryan Nobles, who is out front live in Orange, Texas. The situation there growing more serious at this hour. You've got mandatory evacuations, Ryan, where you are at this moment for pretty much everyone, most people at least, in that town and county. What are you seeing happen?
Yeah, you could tell, Aaron, this is a normally pretty busy part of Orange, Texas right now, and it is pretty much deserted, and that's because we are standing in about 2.5 feet of water, and this water does not appear to be receding in any way, shape, or form, and that is a big concern right now for the emergency management officials in this eastern part of Texas. They are worried that the flooding is not over yet, and it's for a combination of reasons. One being the fact that the Sabine River, which is just about 2 miles from where we're standing, has yet to crest. When that does, that could lead to even more flooding. There's also a dam on the other side of the river in Louisiana, which they are periodically releasing water from to allow some of the pressure to be taken off some of the bodies of water in this community. That also could lead to flooding in this community. So while they felt as though they had gotten through the worst of the storm, this second round of flooding potential has encouraged the emergency management officials to emergency mandatory evacuations for certain parts of Orange County, Texas. Now, it's not the entire county, but there are very specific targeted areas, those low-lying areas close to the Sabine and Neches River, where they've decided just to get people out. And from what we can tell, and we've talked to quite a few people, you know, everyone is heeding these warnings, primarily because they don't want to mess with this because they are not accustomed to this type of flooding. This is a community that in more than 20 years has never seen this level of flooding, so they do not want to mess with it. But Aaron, the next 24 to 48 hours are going to be very important for this community to see if the flooding is going to get any worse. And it's only then that they can really begin the process of rebuilding and recovering from Hurricane Harvey. Aaron?
All right, Ryan, thank you very much. And I want to go now to Judge Jeff Brennick. He is a top official in Jefferson County. That includes Beaumont. It includes Port Arthur, which are two of the hardest hit towns in the past couple of days. Judge, I appreciate your time. We just were talking to our reporter in Beaumont, of course, which has lost its clean water supply. People don't have clean drinking water. It seems unclear at this time when that's going to change. Obviously, this could be life or death. How soon do you think the water will be working?
Well, the forecast is for the river to peak tomorrow about 1 p.m. Once it's peaked, it'll be a several day period during which we'll see some recession of the water. Once the water goes down, then the city crews will be able to get in and try to determine what happened, although we think it's a water inundation caused a short that killed the pump. So they should be able to get after that pretty quickly, and we're hopeful that we'll get water restored at the beginning of the week.
Are you going to be able to get water to your citizens in the meantime? Obviously, if that's, you know, within a few days, I mean, if people don't have water, don't have bottled water, that is life or death. Are they going to be able to get the water they need to drink?
Drinking water shouldn't be a problem. It's sanitary water that's going to be difficult for the citizenry. They're going to have Walmart and HEB, local grocer in Texas, is distributing water as we speak. There are state assets that are coming in. The problem is that the water inundation has blocked all of our major thoroughfares for transportation. Interstate 10, US 69, Highway 90 have been underwater, and so state and federal resources that normally assist us after natural disasters like Hurricane Rita and Ike haven't been able to push in here and deliver them. They're just slowly starting to trickle in this evening as one of the Highway 90 was able to be opened up, but Almost immediately after it opened, there was a refinery explosion over in Houston that closed the western reaches of it. So that further confounded the delivery of goods that could be pushed to points of distribution in the citizens.
So, Judge, I know in Port Arthur, you have people in shelters. They're desperate for supplies. 1,500 people, we know at least, right, have sought refuge in schools or churches, even a bowling alley. And many of these places, we understand, have been, you know, quickly running out of crucial things, food, toiletries, bedding. When will these people get food and relief? Are you able to get that into them?
That should be starting to be distributed this evening. As I said, several 18-wheelers have been able to enter the county through the western portion. Our northern, eastern, and southern areas, there's still no traffic coming in. We've gotten a couple 18-wheelers of cots and blankets and pillows, several 18-wheelers of MREs. So those will be starting to be pushed to the shelters. We've got over 1,000 people at our airport, special needs that are being triaged. They'll be ferried via air to Galveston. From there, they'll be put on AMBuses or buses for delivery to other parts of the state for short-term care.
All right. Well, Judge Brannick, I appreciate your time. Thank you. And, of course, our thoughts are with you. Good luck on that. Some crucial moments here ahead for the county. And next, health crisis. There is a new threat, growing fear tonight over the toxic stew and what it could bring in terms of sickness and disease. Plus, going home, flood victims getting their first look, going back home. And it is too much for some to bear.
To be honest, I don't know if I want to be here very long.
And now, all eyes on this. A Category 3 hurricane forming incredibly early over the Atlantic. Breaking news tonight, a serious and potentially deadly disaster emerging across the Texas coast. Homes, businesses, and streets are flooded, and it's not just water. It's a toxic stew of chemicals, sewage, debris, potentially so hazardous, the EPA and Texas officials are warning the water could be the single biggest threat to public health at this time. Tonight, we're going to go to the center of it all to show you exactly what people in Texas are dealing with tonight. Elizabeth Cohen is out front.
Countless people have waded through these floodwaters, some for hours. Now the question is, what's in it? Alligators, hordes of fire ants, and many things you can't see.
Let's start sampling.
We asked Lane Voorhees, a senior scientist at a Houston water testing lab, to investigate.
What do you think is in this water?
Based on sampling that we've done during previous flooding events and storm events, we're pretty sure there will be various bacteria, which are sewage related, things like E. coliform, fecal strep.
And that's not all.
So now we're testing for chemicals.
Yes, this bottle would be for the various heavy metals, the regulated metals that are immediate health hazards.
So like arsenic, lead?
Yes, arsenic, lead, cadmium.
This water is everywhere.
Yes.
So that means the contamination is?
The potential for contamination is everywhere.
But what does this mean for the people who are in the water? We asked Dr. Brent Cassidy, an emergency medicine specialist.
If you're walking through this water, you cannot see what you're stepping on. It would be very easy to get cut.
Right.
What would you worry about next?
There's obviously a lot of fecal material and sewage and things like that in this water.
What worries you the most about what's in this water? Because a lot of people spend a lot of time in it.
The most concerning thing that you could see would be things like, Vibrio vulnificus, which we hear can cause things like necrotizing fasciitis, those types of really severe skin infections. Yeah, exactly.
The first wave of the disaster? Flooding and rescues. The second wave, the health concerns that come in the aftermath.
Aaron, I want to show you what this water looks like. Take a look. It is a yellowish, brownish color. And those tests that we did to see what's in here, to see what people have been wading through, we'll get those results back in the next day or two, and Aaron will share them with you.
All right, we're gonna have that out front. Thank you very much, Elizabeth. I want to go now to the retired U.S. Army Lieutenant General Russell Honore, who, of course, commanded the military response during Hurricane Katrina. General, this may not surprise you, obviously. I know it doesn't. But when you see this toxic stew that they say could be the single biggest threat to public health right now, sewage, deadly fire ants, all kinds of deadly wildlife, chemicals, toxic chemicals, oil, gas, it is fetid. How big of a fear is this?
It is a fear, and we need to do another risk assessment. Right now, if you lose power in many of these communities, people are still living in their homes.
I just want to interrupt you for a second so people can see what they're looking at right now. I'm sorry, we're showing pictures of the fire ants if people can't see this close, but these are the kind of massive things that are floating around in the water. I'm sorry to interrupt you, General. Go ahead.
Yeah, and a lot of people are still in their homes with water in the street. They're able to do that because the power grid is still up. The power grid goes down like it did in Beaumont today, and we're going to go to a mega disaster here in Dallas. Because of that stock to stew water, if they can't get water through the water system, and if you lose power and it's 93 degrees today, I think a quick assessment need to make based on that what's in the water, that's the flood water, is to start looking at a selected evacuation of high-risk people that are currently in the city that's in the flood zone. If there are nursing homes and hospitals, they're at risk. It's a function of time before more of the grid go down. And I think that should be highest priority of all of government to figure those out, Aaron, and start doing the high-risk evacuation now, because you can still get around this city, but you need to take the risk assessment and move them, because if the grid go down, we're going to have a mess.
Well, that's a terrifying thing to think about, and obviously the grid holding up is one of the incredible things thus far in this disaster. You point out, look, Katrina, they called it a toxic soup, and everything was in there, and of course, as we all know, horrifically, even decomposing human bodies in that water. What can Texas do right now to stop it? Or at this point, it just seems like it is what it is.
Thanks for that focus. What we had, every soldier, sailor, airman, and Marine that walked in that water, we did a hot soap wash down. Number one, try to avoid contact to your skin. If it does get on your skin, you wash it with hot soap. When you go into it and you come back out with your clothes, you wash them off, and we go to spray points. So the people who are still walking in that water, you can do it, but you should have protective clothing on. And if you do get it on your skin, you need to wash it off immediately and make sure any cuts you might have, that you've got a current tetanus shot. It's very significant to have a current tetanus shot. If you don't know, find out. If not, go get one.
So, you know, you told me last night, General, when we were speaking, the response to the crisis, you know, your words were very powerful. You called it amateur hour. Today, the Texas governor, local officials, they came out to praise the response, and here's some of what they said.
I've never seen a president, a vice president, or cabinet who have responded as swiftly and as effectively to people in need, like the people of Texas overcoming the tragedy of Hurricane Harvey.
I think the response has been adequate throughout the community.
At the present time, we think we do have enough boots on the ground.
General, we also spoke to the former FEMA director, David Paulison. He told out front he thinks the response is his words, going well. Are they all wrong? Do you see something different still today?
Well, I see if we don't get more deployment of troops in, we've got to get in every town, every community. We've got to push the National Guard out to the rural areas and get the big troops in to help fix the infrastructure and to continue the search and rescue. I do think we need to scale up. We don't have enough troops here, and they don't have enough on the way. I beg to be wrong and let the politicians be right. But after this search and rescue effort, if they do it to standard and they do it right, unless we got a different way of doing it in Texas, this is going to take 30 to 40,000 people to search all of these homes twice, to include go into them. And on top of that, the possibility of the grid starting to fail based on the floodwaters as they continue to go through the city of Houston. But I hope I'm wrong, and I hope they are right, but I don't see the world the way they see it. I see it through riding around this state 18 hours a day for the last 3 days, and I'm telling you that the thing that's holding up is because his grid holds up. If the lights go out, this is going to be a government changing event here.
Certainly will. General Honore, thank you. And next, live pictures of Dallas, gas station there, running out because of Harvey. And North Carolina just declaring a state of emergency because of anticipated gas shortages as this spreads across the country, plus storm victims going inside their homes for the first time to see what, if anything, is left. We're with the family. Breaking news, 100,000 homes affected by Hurricane Harvey. That is the number tonight from the White House. For some families, their worst fears are being realized. Homes they may frankly never be able to call a home again. Alex Marquardt is out front. And Alex, you went with families as they tried to go home for the first time. What did they find?
That's right, Aaron. Well, now that the rain has stopped and these waters are starting to recede, many people are going home for the first time, assessing the incredible damage in their homes, grabbing whatever valuables they can. It has been absolutely heartbreaking to see people realize the full extent of this damage, as I mentioned, many for the first time. These waters are expected to stay here for around 5 to 6 weeks, but it is still very unclear how many of these homes are still livable.
There's going to be a mailbox here.
This is the first time that Bill Wolf has been able to get back to his house since being evacuated.
Surreal is probably the understatement of the century here. You know, watching a 30-foot fishing boat drive down your street is like something that you've just never seen before. I mean, this is my intersection here. And, Kenny, man, I don't know. This is crazy.
Let's see how high the water is, Bill.
Yeah. So, I mean, we'll see if I can even get in or not.
Captain Kenny Evans is taking Wolf back.
One minute you're stressed about your gutters, and the next minute everything you have is ruined.
It was Evans who rescued the Wolf family, along with their cat and dog.
Last but not least.
In the middle of the storm on Monday.
Oh, Lord. Oh.
After navigating the boat to the door, we wade into the living room.
Oh, boy.
Furniture now floating through past the pictures of his sons.
I'm really proud of them. I'm really proud of them, my wife, my family. And they're tough little kids.
They're holding up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's I'm not an emotional guy, and I'm pretty calm. And this has been too much for me. To be honest, I don't know if I want to be here very long.
Back in the office, the real loss becomes clear.
Got a 150-year-old family Bible under this water.
Stacks of photo albums, baby books, and other sentimental items.
Is this the worst part, is the personal stuff?
Yeah, I mean, this is the stuff that you can't replace, right? I mean, this is, these are my son's birth announcements. Right, I mean.
Upstairs, where it's dry, Wolf throws his son's toys and sheets into garbage bags.
Yeah. So you think there's a possibility you may never live in this house again?
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, it's going to sit here for a month or two with 6 feet of water in it, so.
Up and down this neighborhood today, people taking stock of their belongings and their lives. 86-year-old Ed Wendler is also back for the first time. With Captain Evans, we found him on Monday in his dark bedroom, alone with no power. He needs his medicine, so Evans heads inside, past countless possessions now suspended in the dark floodwaters.
This was Ed's office. All these papers piled high on his desk. You can see now they're all totally ruined. The water in here is so high that back there in the kitchen, the fridge is now floating on its side.
On the boat, Wendler tries to take it all in.
It's very confusing. Can't get it wrapped up in my mind what's going to be next. What I'm going to need to do.
Grab it, grab it!
Wendler and Wolf are just two of the countless people who Captain Evans has helped this week, and his work is far from over.
It's not even real. You see this stuff on TV, but this is total devastation in every way, physically, emotionally.
Aaron, this is the tireless Captain Kenny Evans right here, just a fantastic embodiment of the spirit of Houston and all the people who have come out to help over the past few weeks. Back to you.
All right, thank you. And of course, thanks to him. And I know that those families going home are so grateful. No matter what devastation they found to be able to get any of those pictures, they owe it to you, sir. So thank you. And as families across Texas are dealing with this tragedy, this devastation, this emotional and physical devastation, Vice President Pence was on the ground today. Pence helping to clean up the debris in a badly damaged neighborhood in Rockport. He went and cleared the tree branches from a home, did it in the 90 plus degree heat. Pence also displayed empathy, which is something a White House official told our Jim Acosta the president had failed to do.
To see the outpouring of compassion and concern was deeply inspiring to us. We stood in a yard, we watched total strangers helping to remove debris, helping people put their families and their lives back together.
This is the White House says President Trump will return to the region on Saturday. Up front now, our presidential historian, Douglas Brinkley, who lived through Hurricane Katrina, is author of The Great Deluge, Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans, and the Mississippi Gulf Coast, which, of course, changed forever as this coast now is. Doug, thank you very much. Look, the president was criticized when he was there for not meeting with storm victims. There was no hugging victims or helping out, as we saw from the vice president today. It was a very different set of images. He actually was cleaning up debris. He was hugging people, comforting people. Who, of course, were affected by Hurricane Harvey. What do you make of the contrast?
I think Vice President Pence got it right. You have to show the heart. You've got to hug people, be on the ground, touch people. I think President Trump got off to a bad start. He was doing one of his Twitter things when the storm was starting to hit the Gulf Coast, and we all know what all those were. But then he did the right thing by going in-state, and he had good meetings in Austin. He got to Corpus Christi, but then suddenly he stood against the wall with the crowd about a half a football field away and gave a speech, but there was never a moment where he seemed to be touching the victims of the storm or talking to them. So yeah. There's an empathy deficit going on, and I think the president's going back on Saturday to try to fill
try
that.
To correct that. So let me just give everyone a sense. Like, here's a little bit of what the president said when he went down on his first visit and what Vice President Pence said today. Just to give a sense of President Trump, he said, "We love you. You're special. We're here to take care." And then he continued to say, "Thank you, everybody. What a crowd. What a turnout." And Vice President Pence, of course, as you saw, was more along the lines of, "You've inspired the nation with your resilience and your courage." Those are the words he used. Will we see a change, Trump, when he goes to Houston on Saturday?
He's a germaphobe. I'm not saying that with any derision. He just is. And he may not want to touch that water you've just been showing. He may not want to be hands-on with people. He may not want to go into a shelter, because many people in an unhinged kind of environment might boo and hiss him. So he's probably going to try to meet with some selective people and try to do a little bit more on the empathy thing. But I don't think we're going to see him doing what Pence did today.
Now, he did, though, say he's going to donate $1 million to the Harvey recovery efforts. Obviously, that is a lot of money, and that is an important thing to do. Is it possible that that's just sort of who he is, and that's the way he's going to do it, and that's significant contribution, but he's not going to be able to be the empathetic, touchy-feely person?
I agree. And a big thumbs up. He gave $1 million. It's the right thing to do, so we have to give him credit for that. But history's not going to look well on what's going on. Many people are saying this is a climate event. We've had months, unbelievably bizarre monsoons in India, in Nepal, and now we're having perhaps Irma coming. People have to talk about climate change. He is not only pulled out of Paris, doesn't want to talk about it, and is going to find himself saying Texas is going to be bigger and better. Governor Abbott today said we need $100 billion probably, and that's going to be hard to get Congress to do that. So he's going to have to show some great leadership, getting the money in the next week.
All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, Doug. And next, two brothers drive 7 hours to help with rescues, carrying people on their backs to safety. Their story next. There are guests and a dangerous storm gaining strength in the Atlantic. This one forming well before a storm normally does. It's already a Category 3. The storm track next. News. Our cameras captured a daring helicopter rescue late today near Beaumont. In that area, of course, where the mandatory evacuation order is in effect, a rescuer lowered from a helicopter into rapidly moving floodwater, as you can see there, trying to rescue a man who was clinging to a tree, as you can see back there. where there's the water rushing by. It is one of the amazing rescue missions we have seen this week from the devastating floodwaters in Texas. There are so many people who are risking their own lives to try to help. Two of them are brothers Joshua and Jonathan Avola. You're looking at them here. They saw the destruction on television. They got in their truck, decided to go and help. It was a 200-mile trip from Joshua's home near Dallas, and it took nearly 7 hours as you guys braved the storm and the floods. I know you've aided in about 200 rescues along with your friends, and thank both of you for coming on with us. This is one of your rescues. Jonathan on the right, helping a group lift an elderly woman in a wheelchair to safety. And then they helped another elderly woman, as you can see here on Jonathan's back. I know you rescued her husband, their bedridden son, their two grandchildren, all of them out thanks to you. The water inside that home was rising quickly, already on seat level for their couch and chairs. Joshua and Jonathan Avola, you saw them there, are here with me, and thanks to both of you. Jonathan, let me start with you. I know you've helped in dozens of rescues here over the past couple of days. That video of you carrying Mrs. Gonzalez on your back is very touching. Tell us about what happened with her and her family.
Well, we responded to a distress call that was sent in that night. It was Sunday night. We were headed from the Dallas area to Houston, and our friends that were contacted saying that this family was left behind and they couldn't get out. It was a complicated situation because of the son that was bedridden. He just had a major surgery and he couldn't walk or sit up on his own. And they were afraid that if they weren't taken out that night, that they might not make it through the night. So Joshua, he obviously spearheaded this whole us coming out here. And we got there at about midnight, Sunday night, and we were able to dock off of a highway ramp and make it there by boat. Took us about an hour to get through there with the boat. And once we got into the house, we were able to help them get to safety. It was dark, it was cold, and they were all really scared, but thankfully we were able to get them to
safety. I'm sure they were, because Joshua, I know the neighborhood that you went into in this rescue really had already been cleared out. I mean, so theoretically everybody was out, but of course they weren't. And you went back in and you found this family. I mean, look, you were here by choice. You're here to try to do good things. I mean, were you scared?
Well, of course, I was watching the comfort of my home, my children, Sunday, and it just didn't feel right laying on a couch and watching Houston suffer. It almost felt like a sin. And so I felt that God put on my heart to call my brother and say, we're going to Houston. And of course, it was scary, but when you're going off of faith and you're going off of adrenaline and you're going off of basically selflessness, which I think I'm not the only one, I think everyone out there just completely stopped thinking about themselves for once and started thinking about humanity, started thinking about safety and love. And it's just very touching. It's moving. I mean, it chokes me up. I'm going to try to hold it together. But I just can't believe how many people came together in the middle of all these this politics trash. And I'm sorry to call it that. But, the racism and all this bad news that we've been hearing. Even though this is bad news, of course, it's heartbreaking, it's a beautiful thing to see everybody come together, and I can almost see the joy in everybody's hearts and in their faces just because of the unity that was coming together. So yeah, it was very scary. We went through that neighborhood. It was eerie. It was dark. The water was almost black just from the sewage and the contamination. You can see it in the picture there, how dark the water is. Almost up to the mailbox. We made it to these folks' home. I can't even believe that we made it there and connected to where they opened the door. And this elderly gentleman let us in. We go into the room. You can look back there. We're shining the light. The room is just ahead. And the gentleman just got through having surgery. He's laying in bed, water inches away from his wounds, which could have gone septic. A little girl sitting on a couch, probably 6 or 7 years old, on the back seat of the couch, just shivering and scared to death. That broke my heart. I had to turn away a few times. And if somebody has to do, you know how it is. Somebody has to do be the cameraman. You know, the cameraman doesn't get to be in the picture, but it's okay because my brother has the brawn and I have the brain, so it worked out anyway. But anyway, so we carried those guys out of there and got them on a boat, kept them out of that septic water, that trash water, and carried them to safety. And I just want to say something. I want to thank the people that are behind the scenes, like the Prietos, like Tracy and Michael Prieto, who were our connections to here. And I know that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people that were first responders that have people in the background scene that have been spearheading, have been giving them shelter, food. If it wasn't for those folks, we would not have been able to be so successful. And so, very touching, very moving. I love seeing Texas come together. We love seeing the rednecks and the city folks come together as one, as in unity. Nobody criticizing about camouflage or hunting. It just shows. It shows that us, and I'm a hunter myself, and it shows that whenever it comes down to people uniting for one cause and one purpose, we were actually almost conditioned for this. If you think about it, a lot of the hunters and the fishermen were almost conditioned for this. Isn't it nice to know that we have so many boats out there?
That's incredible, the boats, and that everyone is willing to use them to do this. I mean, you know, Jonathan, I know you were visiting your brother in Texas. So you obviously did the drive together, but you live in California. You had a flight to go home. You let it go. You decided to stay. You decided to help. That's got to be now one of the most important decisions you've ever made.
Yeah, it's not easy. I'm seeing all these kids that we're helping out and the families, and I'm thinking about mine in the background. My wife, Amy, and my two boys, Zachariah and Zaylin, are in San Diego now. They left Monday morning. First thing, I was supposed to be on the flight with them. And, they were willing to make the sacrifice and let me go with Joshua to help these people in Houston. And, it's a big sacrifice that they made. And I miss them very much. I've been gone since, I haven't seen them since Sunday. And hopefully I can see them soon. But right now there's a huge need here, and we're doing what we can to help.
All right. Well, I know everyone is so okay. Sorry, a quick final word. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say, speaking of that, we do need to thank our wives back at home for taking care of the children and for being so understanding and selfless to lend their husbands, thousands and thousands of husbands. And I'm not saying just husbands. I'm sure wives and women came out to help, of course. But we want to thank our wives for that. And before you let us go, I do want to mention just a few names of some folks I want to thank, because it's very important to point out that we weren't us two here. Yeah, we might be in front of the camera, but we had a whole team from Ellis County. We call them the Ellis County group. We had Matt Kiever and Bradley Tyner and Eric Meyer, Matt Bowling, Pastor Buck. We just had Pastor Todd Gray. So many people that responded and dropped everything. I mean, from business owners to people working for corporations and pastors. And it's just wonderful seeing all that. It's really moving.
And I know they have all done so much, as have you both. And I thank you very much for your time tonight. Next, the Category 3 hurricane churning in the Atlantic could be heading towards the United States. It has formed incredibly early. It is incredibly strong. We have that track and more breaking news with stations running out of gas in Texas and a state of emergency in North Carolina, all because of Harvey. We're going to show you what's happening to gas. Breaking news, growing concern across the nation about gas shortages because of Hurricane Harvey as far away as North Carolina, where the governor declared a state of emergency already today. This is video from Dallas, massive lines at the pump. Allison Kosick is out front live in Dallas. And Allison, how bad is the situation there?
Well, it's definitely not looking good, Aaron. If you're looking to fill up your tank with gas in the Dallas area, you're either going to find one of two things. You'll either find gas stations fresh out of supply, no gas there at that Texaco, or you're going to find huge lines at gas stations all over Dallas. I know our crew car ran out of gas. We were on empty. It took us four stations to find one that had gas, and then we had to wait a good 45 minutes to get up to the pump. I talked with one guy who had to drive 35 miles to find gas, and he ran out of gas in the process and had to push his car to the pump. So why is this happening? A couple of reasons. For one, it's a distribution issue. It's a supply issue. Refineries in Port Arthur and in Houston are shut down. Those are the refineries that service this area of Dallas, that service Dallas entirely. And when they're shut down, it means the actual supply of gasoline can't get here. Secondly, there was a frantic call on social media, on Facebook and on Twitter, showing pictures like this of long lines, long gas lines. Also, the higher price is not helping either. We're seeing the price of gas up at least 10 cents a gallon over the past week, and we're seeing prices very different all over Dallas. I saw one gas station for a gallon of regular $4.49 a gallon. Some would call that price gouging. That takes an investigation, but we're definitely seeing a situation where you're seeing a rush of everybody sort of depleting the source of gas. Erin?
Right, thank you very much. It's pretty stunning to see that. And also tonight, as we're dealing with that, fears are growing along the Gulf about another powerful and dangerous hurricane. All eyes now shifting to what's called Hurricane Irma, already a Category 3. Tom Sater is out front in the Weather Center. And Tom, where is Irma headed and will it get much stronger? Already a Category 3 and it's still so far away.
It's unbelievable, Aaron. I mean, just yesterday it was named as a tropical storm, and now it went to Category 1, 2, 3. That's a major hurricane. We're not following this because of the damage in Harvey, but you see where Miami is? 3,000 miles away. Here is Irma. We watch these tropical waves come off the coast of Africa, but this one caught our eye because it's such extreme growth in its early birth. But again, this system is making its way toward the Caribbean, and it looks like it's got its eyes on the southeastern U.S. So the National Hurricane Center carries it up to a Category 4 before the Leeward Islands. The computer models, Aaron, are in great agreement, like they were with Harvey. But where does it go after this? Because the further out in time you go, it starts to spread. Let me show you the European model. This one handled Harvey very well. I'm going to put it into motion for you. This tropical wave, with one following off the coast of Africa behind it, makes its way as Category 4, goes toward Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Hispaniola. We'll have to watch interaction with land. But on Saturday night, in between Florida and Cuba, it's a major Category 4. It could make its way toward the Carolinas, could impact Florida, or slide and bypass Florida into the Gulf. The U.S. model, the GFS, has it about 1,000 miles away. Now, this is just to the west of Bermuda toward Cape Cod. But to tell you, I mean, we're really watching the southern track, because if we have a landfall, Aaron, believe it or not, that could be 9/11. Between September 11th and maybe the 12th or 13th. So there's somewhat a variable. We need 4 or 5 more days, Aaron, really, to keep an eye on this.
All right. Thank you very much. Sure. Pretty frightening there to imagine here this next one coming. I want to turn to another story breaking, though, right now, and that's the Russia investigation. President Trump's lawyers have met with special counsel Robert Mueller. Trump's team meeting with Mueller more than once to argue the president did not obstruct justice in firing the former FBI director Jim Comey. Manu Raju is out front. Manu, significant reporting here that there have been meetings between Trump's legal team and Bob Mueller. What more do you know?
Yeah, meetings and memos provided to Trump's to the special counsel from Trump's legal team, saying that the president did not obstruct justice in his handling of the James Comey situation and his firing of the FBI director. In fact, saying that it was well within his constitutional authority to do so, even raising questions about Comey's credibility. But Aaron, we do know that the president, when he did fire James Comey, he later said publicly that the Russia investigation was on his mind. But still, they're trying to contend in these private discussions. There was nothing illegal, nothing wrong, and it was constitutional. And as we know, Bob Mueller's looking into that issue of obstruction. We'll see if it carries any muster with them.
And we know, obviously, that's a big issue. And you also, Manu, have more news on the Jim Comey front tonight.
Yeah, that's right. Chuck Grassley, the Republican chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and Lindsey Graham, the Republican on that committee as well, announcing today that they have received transcripts from the FBI, from FBI officials, saying that James Comey had essentially reached a conclusion about the Hillary Clinton email investigation in April or in May of 2016. That was before even interviewing Hillary Clinton, according to these transcripts that they have released. They were heavily redacted transcripts. They're saying this is not the way to run an investigation, and it shows that Comey, they believe, reached a conclusion about the Hillary Clinton email matter before actually interviewing her, before interviewing some key witnesses. Now, Comey, a source close to Comey, pushing back on that assessment, saying that he had not reached a conclusion, is actually just looking at this as a possibility that she would not be actually charged with anything criminally, but clearly here possibly more fodder for the White House. Sarah Huckabee Sanders jumping on this report earlier today. Clearly the White House sees this as well to give them some cover in their firing of James Comey.
All right, Manu, thank you very much with those breaking developments at this hour. And thanks to all of you for joining us.